I think it's a tool we all have, Mark. I think we all were born, as you know, with an imagination, and as kids, we probably really went for it. And then we kind of got sometimes channeled into these places of you've got to make a living, you got to da 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 da. So it was a great, fun kind of respite, but it helps you get comfortable in your skin as you're playing with people in improv and kind of get courage and, you know, just have fun. Imagination. It's like the best muscle we have. And I have to say, I'm glad I found it sooner than later as an adult.
Welcome to the Stark Reflections on Writing and Publishing podcast. There has never been a better time for writers. More information, options, and opportunities are available to you. But navigating these requires insight. Join Mark Leslie Lefebvre as he draws upon more than a quarter century of experience as a writer, a bookseller, and a trusted book industry consultant to explore and reflect on the writing and publishing landscape to help you make informed choices on your writer journey.
Hello, Reflectives, and welcome to episode 283 of the Stark Reflections podcast. This is your host, Mark Leslie Lefebvre. In today's episode, I have an interview with Amy S. Peele. Amy is an Amazon bestselling and award-winning author. Her Transplant Medical Murder Mystery series is referred to as mystery with a mission and a side of humor. We talk about her writing, her healthcare background, comedy, laughing yoga, and so much more. And that's coming up later in this episode. But first, let's hear a word about this episode's sponsor. This episode is sponsored by Findaway Voices. What is Findaway Voices, you might be asking? Well, if you're a longtime listener, you're probably not asking that question because you already know that Findaway Voices is a platform that allows you to get your audiobook into the market, helps you with the creation of the audiobook, and helps you with the distribution of your audiobook to more than 40 retail and library platforms. But something you probably don't know, well, maybe you do know because you've already heard this, but I'm going to share it now. Something you may not know or you may be excited to know is that Findaway Voices is now empowering authors on Spotify. That's right. They're owned by Spotify. The Findaway Voices mother company, Findaway, was purchased by Spotify. Spotify earlier this year announced that they have launched audiobooks, a la carte audiobook sales into the U.S., UK, Australia, New Zealand, and Ireland markets. I think I got all of those right. But they're now empowering authors on Spotify, and they've just announced this week, yes, that's right, this week, which is the second last week in December, that they're allowing giveaway codes on Spotify. Now, giveaway codes were something that Findaway always had for Authors Direct, but now they have giveaway codes for Spotify as well. They unlock audiobooks on the Spotify platform. Every single book that you publish to Spotify through Findaway Voices, you can get 100 giveaway codes for. That's a pretty awesome opportunity. Now, Spotify is a gigantic platform that has millions and millions of listeners around the world. Audiobooks are new to Spotify, so this is your opportunity to get into Spotify with your audiobooks and get some traction and the algorithms working for you, because giving the books away or some of your books selectively to certain people, potentially certain people on your newsletter, is a great way to get that traction on a new platform. Most new platforms that exist, we can't figure out ways to get traction, but Findaway Voices is making it easier for you. One of the things I did with this within a few days of the announcement was I sent out an email to my newsletter. It's the Christmas season. It's the season of giving. It's the season of all kinds of wonderful things like that. And so I just put out a call to my newsletter. I listed 5, 6, 7, 8, maybe 8 or 9 of my audiobooks. I created a simple form. You can do this in Google Form. I used Woofoo. And I basically said, hey, I'd love to give you one of my audiobooks on Spotify. You can claim it. Just click this, you click a link and it'll go right to your Spotify account. And then you can enjoy my audiobooks. And I did let people know that I had a limited number available. And I said, select soon because I might run out. So I asked them to do a first pick and a second pick. And the reaction was relatively positive. It was relatively good. I got some good engagement of people who replied and asked me for a specific audiobook. That's all just part of building your brand, building your audience onto a new platform. So that's just one of the great things that Findaway Voices is doing. And if you want to see how you can leverage Findaway Voices as an author, you can check them out over at starkreflections.ca/findaway. For the comment section of the show, this episode, I'm going to share a question. This question that came in from a listener to the podcast, and I answered it, and they said, yes, I can use the question and the answer in an episode of the podcast, so all listeners could benefit from it in case other people are in a similar boat. But I did want the person who asked the question to remain anonymous. So the actual written question, I've slightly modified here and edited it so it makes more sense to protect the identity of the individual who asked it. So I've taken a little bit of creative license in the question, but it's pretty much the genesis or the heart of the question. So here is the question. Dear Mark, you are so awesome. No, I'm just kidding. I added that. I was intrigued to see that you have a three-part name, and I hope you have some thoughts on using three-part names as an indie author. I currently use a two-name pseudonym for my traditionally published books. I'm considering using my two-part real name for my indie career, but I'm wondering if it makes good business sense to insert my middle name. On the pro side, this would make author branding, all links, social media, and URLs somewhat easier and fit perfectly with my heritage genre niche. It would also prevent confusion with another author with the same name who writes different types of books. Now on the con side, I fear that a three-part name would be less easy for readers to remember and may sound a bit preposterous, like a Victorian novelist, Louisa May Alcott, Lucy Maud Montgomery, or a white guy's novelist, David Foster Wallace. I also know that you use only Mark Leslie for fiction, so you may have a reason to avoid three names. I'm wondering if you could share your thoughts on this topic and whether you would recommend it for an indie historical fiction writer like myself. Do you have any insights or advice or anything you wish you'd known before adopting a pen name with a middle name? Is it helpful or problematic in any way? Well, thank you, fellow three-name person. That was a great question. Let me go back in time. So I started to write under the name Mark Leslie right from the very beginning because all my life, nobody knew how to spell or pronounce Lefebvre. I'm sure listeners of the podcast know how to pronounce Lefebvre because you hear me saying it all the time. But one of the reasons I went with that is it felt good because Leslie was my middle name, so it was still me. And when I was a teenager, and I'd started submitting my stuff when I was 15 years old, or I got my first rejection when I was 15, I may have started a little bit earlier, I was a big fan of Piers Anthony, the Xanth novels, Incarnations of Immortality, and I knew, I'd learned in his author notes, which I've adapted for a lot of my writing, is that his real name was Piers Anthony Jacob Dillingham, something like it. A really long name that went on for, like pi. Pi, 3.14, etc. And he just dumbed it down to Piers Anthony. So it was part of his name. And I thought, oh, that's kind of cool. I can do what he did. He also said, well, that also put him at the beginning of the alphabet. And I said, oh, neat. I'm in the L still, just like I would have been. So it's like natural for me. Anyways, the only reason that I've ended up using Mark Leslie Lefebvre for, this podcast, as well as for the books that I have published for writers in my Stark, what is it called? Stark Publishing Solutions imprint, was because over the years, over, 30 years, I had developed a reputation in the book industry and in some parts of the indie author community as Mark Lefebvre, the day job I've had since 1992, or day jobs I've had day careers. What do you call it? Anyways, so I was known as Mark LaFave to a lot of people, and I didn't want to lose that, but I also didn't want to lose the full thing. So I went with Mark Leslie LaFave, partially to distinguish my business of bookselling and writing books and persona from the Mark Leslie persona who writes fiction and ghost story nonfiction books. But it was also to ensure if people wanted to cross over, if they learned something from Mark Leslie LaFave, but then also found out that he had true ghost story books, for example, and they were fans, I wanted them to easily be able to find me. So it wouldn't be hard to know, hey, this Mark Leslie guy and this Mark Leslie LaFave guy are just two personas of the same guy. Anyway, so it's the same guy writing for specifically different audiences. So there's a way to distinguish the brand, but it also allows people to connect it because I'm not trying to hide my other lives, et cetera, et cetera. If that was the case, I'd use a completely different pseudonym. And I had, in the past, for some submissions, created a completely different pseudonym as well. May have been along the lines of that more active romance style writing. Anyways, I like your reasoning for why you're interested or considering using the three names, particularly if it's going to appeal to the right type of audience, because it helps identify you in a certain way. I love that. The social media thing can work too, which is great. So you don't have to rebuild it again, provided you're okay with the crossover. Now, see, I messed up, and half of my social media is Mark Leslie, which again is much shorter and so much easier for everyone. But the other half of my social media, or maybe other half, the three quarters of my social media, is Mark Leslie LaFave. Now, one of the reasons is that Mark Leslie was often taken already, so I couldn't take it. And I didn't think to use Mark Leslie author right away. It came along later. But anyways, I doubt anyone is going to use the longer one. Now, there is a Mark Leslie in the high-tech business world, and he's a phenomenally rich and successful guy. He doesn't have my dad jokes, and who knows if he has my dad jokes. But anyways, but he's this rich tech guy named Mark Leslie. So he bought MarkLeslie.com. I'm not going to be getting that from him for any cheap price at any time soon, which is why I went with MarkLeslie.ca for my website. But there's at least one other Mark Leslie author that I've seen on online catalogs, etc. He doesn't seem to write close to what I write, and so far it hasn't been an issue, but I think I've also produced enough stuff so that he's the other Mark Leslie rather than me being the other Mark Leslie. I'm also a big fan of using the name to ensure you're not mistaken for another author. Now, I explained why I don't think this other Mark Leslie and I are going to get confused with one another, but I have a friend. I have a writer friend in the Toronto area named Stephen King. And I worked with him for a number of years in bookselling. We worked at Chapters head office years ago, or Chapters Indigo it became. Now Stephen's a brilliant writer of, yes, speculative fiction. Basically, the same sort of genre area that Stephen King does a lot of his writing in. And my friend Stephen, he's proud of his family name. He's proud of his family. He's proud of his heritage. And obviously, he couldn't really write under it because, you know, people were likely to think or assume that he was trying to trick people into thinking he was the other guy and et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. So he writes under Stephen Graham King. And that's worked out well for him because we know who he is. And he's a great writer, so check him out. But in any case, that was a long answer to a really awesome question, and I'm hoping that this was helpful or useful to you. So thanks for a great question, and thanks for letting me share my answer here on this podcast. I'm not going to do any other comments in this episode because that was a really long question and a much, much longer answer because, you know, I'm not really good at the what do you call it, when you truncate something, abridgment. I'm not good at abridging the answers, am I? No, I'm not. But if anyone else has questions, you can feel free to send me, you leave them in the comments over at starkreflections.ca. Email them, especially if they're longer, mark@markleslie.ca. Again, if you're a patron, you can also message me on that platform as well. I want to say thank you for a great question, and thanks to all my listeners. I hope this was a useful answer for others out there who are considering their writing career. Now, I am not, as I said, going to get into comments. I'm actually not even going to do a personal update for this episode, but I did want to share this really, really important thing. And that's kind of related to this question. Is this question sort of a, hey, I'm at the beginning of this new part of my writing career. I want to, you know, do some stuff with a different name. And here's what I'm thinking of. And I have heard from listeners multiple times, from multiple listeners who appreciate hearing stories of writers who are closer to the beginning of their writing career. And I'm looking for guests. So if you're a listener to the podcast and you're at the beginning or near the beginning of your author career, I'd love an opportunity to chat with you, to talk about what you're doing, where you're learning, some of the questions you have. It could be beneficial to both of us, chance for us to record that conversation, put it on the podcast, because I know it's going to benefit other listeners who are coming along, who are early on in their career and are looking for guidance and support. And so you can help them and help me, and everyone's helped, and we're all happy and shiny and happy people. Little REM earworm in there for you. But similarly, I mean, if you do want to be a guest on the Stark Reflections podcast, I'm not going to hold any writing or publishing experience you have against you. Now, I am currently, you know, eager to speak to more beginning writers. I want to make sure I have a number of beginning writers over the next year so that I can ensure you listeners are enjoying the conversations. I am, of course, interested in speaking to people outside the writing community. I've had musicians and artists on the show before, and I know we can always learn from them. So I will have a link in the show notes over at starkreflections.ca for episode 283, which is this episode, for a form where you can fill it out and let me know if you're interested in being a guest. If you are a listener to the podcast and you know someone else who you think would make an awesome guest. No, again, just say, yeah, I'd love for you, you know, go talk to Stephen King or someone. Like, yeah, that's great. No, unless you're personal friends with the author and can connect me with them. Yeah, I'd love to talk. Yeah, I'd love to interview Ryan Reynolds too. But, you know, unless you have a connection, don't fill out the form and say, yeah, I'd love to hear some from this person. But if you do have a connection with them, or you're an agent or a publicist or et cetera, you can still fill out the form and connect me with the person that you want to introduce me with. Okay, so that's it for the introductory matter for this episode. Why don't we get into this interview with Amy S. Peele? Hey, Amy, thanks for coming on the Stark Reflections podcast.
Well, thank you for having me. I'm excited to be here.
We have so many fun things to talk about. But before we get into your novels and your writing life, I want to go to, and potentially this is prior to your writing life or prior to your publishing life, that you've been an RN since 1974?
That's correct. I'm still here, alive, breathing, kicking. And I still get together with my nursing school friends every year. So yeah,
it's what a nursing school friends. So these are friends you've had for decades then.
Right, right. And the friendship piece actually, Mark, is kind of real important. It's a priority for me.
Right.
So I still have friends from kindergarten that I see, high school and nursing school. And then of course, colleagues when I, you know, retired. And in my book series, it's two best friends, because that's kind of a theme both in my life and my values. And then I just decided, why not have two protagonists instead of just one? So I have two best friends from nursing school.
Oh my god, that's fantastic. I love that. I love that. So almost like Hardy Boys kind of, right? The brothers or best friends.
It is a little bit Hardy Boys, only the grown-up Hardy, probably Nancy Drew sisters in terms of
Nancy Drew sisters. Yeah.
There is some, you know, swears and some alcohol and some not sex, not gratuitous, but they are gals. They're in their 30s. And So, you know, sometimes life gets a little hard for the character, so they do, you know, need a cocktail, or maybe they're going to use a couple swear words.
So I love that. I love that, that your, you know, the importance of friendships in your life have inspired the characters in your book. So, but the other thing is the character, your series are medical mysteries. So you've got three novels so far in the series?
Correct. Yeah, yeah.
Medical mysteries of two best friends. And now, are they both nurses?
They are both nurses. And it's a trilogy. So I was in transplant, my last big career job. I was in organ tissue transplant for 35 right. years. But my last big job was a director at UCSF in San Francisco, where we did about 600 solid organ transplants a year.
600 a year.
Yeah. So it was quite one of the largest programs in the country, if not the world. And what I found during this, it was a stressful job and also very rewarding. Oh, however, man. There were some people I didn't like, but I had to be professional. So I decided to kill them in my murder mysteries and use their organs for transplant.
Oh my God, I love that.
So it was very cathartic. And I also got to weave in what I know about transplant and friendship and, you know, and then what to do with that kind of energy when someone's saying something to you and you're like, are you really saying that out loud? And you can't really tell them what you think because you're going to be professional. So I just went ahead and killed them.
Killed them in your fiction. Yeah, there's that old saying, the sticker you can put on your laptop or a t-shirt saying, be careful, I'm a writer, I'll kill you in my next story. I love that. So You said something, that, and I just want to clarify what this means. You said solid organ transplant. What is that to, you know, the person who wouldn't understand what that means?
Oh, good question, Mark. Yeah, so kidneys and livers, hearts, lungs, solid organ transplants.
Okay.
And then, of course, we did some pancreas, which is the organ that helps with diabetes and, you know, or lack thereof. And then islet cells we did, but that's less of a solid organ because the islet cells are part of the pancreas that actually excrete the insulin. So, but for the most part, it was all solid organ transplants. And as opposed to, say, we don't refer to bone marrow transplants as solid organ.
Of course, right.
Yeah, yeah, but I mean, if you're not in that world and talking about it all the time, people hear the word transplant and they kind of can go all different directions, right?
Right, yeah. So the mysteries, let's talk about this, the trilogy. Does that mean that you've wrapped it up or are there going to be more adventures coming?
Well, you know, I like the question and I actually would like to say I have an answer, but for now, I think part of my journey was when I retired in 2014 and I didn't have transplant out of my system yet because it was a real passion for me as well as a career. So I wrote the three murder mysteries and they would say there were mysteries with a mission and a side of humor because that's what came up as. So my two gals, the third one just came out Hold in October. And over this last year and next year, I'll be writing something non-medical.
Okay.
I made up a whole thing in Chicago because that's where I'm from and with some new characters. And I'm going to let Jackie and Sarah, who are my main characters in the trilogy, they're going to take a little vacay.
Okay.
And if they come knocking again, you know, who knows? I had fun with them. People like them. They say they want to hang out with them. And I did enjoy hanging out with them while I was writing. They're pretty crazy characters. So that's kind of where the trilogy is going to, you know, it's out on audio. The books are out in the world. And now I get to dig into a romantic comedy genre and have some
romantic
fun.
Romantic comedy in Chicago. Oh, so I love that you're going into a different. So let's talk about, so you picked murder mystery and now you're doing romantic comedy. Is that because these are genres you enjoy reading?
Well, I never read that many rom-coms. Truth, I've watched a million like most people are, and you kind of always know what the end is going to be. And
well,
I have
of course, that's the joy
right?
of it.
Right?
You're
like,
it's
oh, God.
Be a happy ending.
Right. You get to you're almost saying, they got to get together. They just got to get together, right? Of course they do. But we all sit there waiting for that to happen, even though in our mind, we know it's going to happen.
Right.
So I have a literary agent, and she signed me and then said, finish your trilogy and then write me a rom-com. And first I'm rom-com, like, what's that? I'm like, sure. Yeah, absolutely. And then thinking, oh, little, and it was like romantic comedy. But so, yeah, it's, you know, there's still character development, and plot development. And it's more lighthearted. You know, I didn't really kill anybody in it yet. There is an opening scenes in a fun funeral parlor in Chicago, the oldest one.
Well, someone had to die for that to happen.
Exactly. But I just want to know, I didn't kill them. They showed up on the first page and they were already dead. Right, so okay,
fair enough. You found them that way.
Not okay. My fault.
But I guess there's some similarities when you think about the romantic comedy, like in a murder mystery, you know that the detectives, you know that the people that are investigating the murder are going to find out who done it. And yeah. So you know that that's going to happen and the fun is getting there. And the same thing in a romantic comedy is, you know, they're going to get together, but there's going to be hurdles and challenges along the way. The try fails, all those things.
Right. Right. And that's kind of fun. It's a little less, you know, you don't have to put red herrings in a romantic comedy, you know, like leading the reader off to the left or the right or not too far off. But in the romantic comedy, it is. And to me, I'm having a little more fun with the genre. So I'm a little not guaranteeing they're going to be together, but you'll have to read the book because it's a really great last scene.
But that's the contract you have with the reader.
I do. And the reader, I will not disappoint. I will not disappoint, but it was very fun getting there, let's say.
Oh, fun stuff. Good stuff. So I have to ask, is the characters in this book, are they based on relationships, like long-term relationships you've had as well, or a different sort of approach to this one?
In the new book, they do. They're different, very different than I've written before. But when I started outlining and sketching and, you know, character development, they popped up. So some of them are, most of my characters are kind of a collective composite of people I know.
Of course, yeah.
So I go, are you Sarah? Are you Jackie? I'm like, no, because see, I had a lot of friends in nursing school and I'm grateful to have friends in my life. So I just take the kind of things from each of their personalities, characteristics, kind of mix an old character cocktail there and then, you know, give it a little bit more depth and have fun with it.
So it's funny that you moved to romantic comedy, because I was reading on your website about your experience with comedy and improv and your involvement in Second City, Chicago, because that's where you're from, right?
Right. I'm from Chicago. And because my day job in transplant was pretty intense, talking to donor families to ask if they'd like to donate and working with transplant recipients, some who made it, some who did not. I realized I needed to have some kind of levity in my life. Right. So I sent myself to it's called the Players Workshop, and it's the training ground for Second City. And it's a year long course. And you show up and use your imagination. That's it. Nobody knew who I was. I mean, I'm not running from the law, by the way, but nobody knows what you do. You just show up and they give you these really silly, fun things to do and practice. And then at the end, it culminates in a graduation on stage at Second City in Chicago. I have to say, it's probably one of the best things I ever did for myself, because it really helped balance, you know, 24/7 intense world of health, medicine and transplant, which I love. But you do need something on the side or something helpful. And I also feel like in that intense environment that I was in for so long, you got to play with people. People want to play, you know, not obviously not in the OR, but you know what I mean? Like when you're in a meeting or hanging out, I used to do impressions of one of the surgeons. I did pretty good. He was a rather large, tall fellow, kind of like Sully, you know, from Monsters, Inc. And I could do a really good John Roberts. He you know, didn't really say a lot. He grunted more than he talked, but great surgeon. So I feel like I think it's a tool we all have, Mark. I think we all were born, as you know, with an imagination. And as kids, we probably really went for it. And then we kind of got sometimes channeled into these places of you've got to make a living, you got to da 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 da. So it was a great, fun kind of respite. And then also just it's really good because I spoke a lot as a professional and I do a lot of speaking now, but it helps you get comfortable in your skin as you're playing with people in improv and kind of get courage and, you know, just have fun, imagination. It's like the best muscle we have. And I have to say, I'm glad I found it sooner than later as an adult.
I love that. So you talked about your literary agent, and I want to go back into some of the mechanics. So, you know, with your murder mystery series, with the romantic comedy coming out, how did you approach that in terms of, I have an idea, I'm going to write them. And then of course the whole process of finding an agent, publisher, et cetera. How did all that work for you?
Well, it's a journey, and you probably know a bit about it, I would expect. And I think the first part was just finding a book coach. because I wanted, I was still working full time and it was a park your life at the door job, but I also wanted to start sketching out the first book. Right. And so I did, but when I and I had the whole outline and the characters, and then she also happened to be started a press 10 years ago called She Writes Press, Brooke Warner. So she knew my writing, and it's a hybrid press, meaning the author pays some, and then you partner with the print, and then they have a, you know, international and national distribution. So the first book cut, I worked with She Writes Press as well as the other two. And I really wanted it out at a certain time. I wanted it out in April because that's National Donor Awareness Month. And so I was up with that first deadline. And then I just wanted those books to come out as part and parcel of awareness of the topic. Then what happened, though, is then what is I was at a mystery writing conference here. I'm in Northern California outside of San Francisco. And we have a great independent bookstore, Book Passage. And I went to this mystery writing conference, Anyway, they said you could pitch an agent because I hadn't had an agent yet. I had my first book was done. I was doing well, winning awards. So I, literally scared, went in, was ready with my pitch sheet and my, you know, and she signed me. Now, she read my book. We met at BoucherCon, the International Mystery Writing Conference. And so she signed me and she, Kimberly Cameron, and I was shocked, honestly. You know, it's hard to get an agent. And I had thought maybe I wouldn't in my travels as a writer. I didn't know what the journey would honestly look truthfully. And but that happened, and I've been with her since then. So now I'm gonna hand her a yummy rom-com to sell, and we'll see what when it's done. It's not done, but I'm working on it.
And that was her. She wanted a rom-com from you when you, so was that what you pitched to her, or did you talk?
I didn't pitch. I just said, you know, I basically pitched myself the first book, the second or third book were not being birthed yet. And so I had already idea about the second book and I knew what the third book was going to be. And so she just, you know, she was, she's a great agent and she's patient and she doesn't give her authors deadlines and she works really hard. So I'm grateful it happened.
And you mentioned that she had said, okay, finish the trilogy and then give me, it demonstrates the flexibility of certain agents to be able to embrace, okay, you approached like the original publication, you approached that hybrid publishing approach where you worked with a publishing outfit that provided the, well, they provide the mechanism, they provide the editorial and stuff like that, but it's a collaborative payment process where you both invest in the book. And then some agents might poo-poo that, or might just go, oh no, you're not for me. But I love the fact that she was embracing you as the writer.
I had no idea. I, you know, I had no expectation. I was very honored to even have the meeting, and I was excited about that. And, you know, she also knew the publisher, Book She Writes Press is kind of one of the stellar independent publishing presses around the country. And so it's got a good reputation, and she totally has her finger on the pulse of that industry. So she knew I was going to have a good product, and she believed in me as a writer, which, you know, when you're a writer, sometimes you do believe in yourself and sometimes you're like, what was I thinking?
So how important then are relationships in the publishing, in the publishing world? I know, you know, they're important in the medical.
Right. Well, I think I take them one at a time, and I know I have a good, healthy relationship with my agent. I also have a strong, healthy relationship with my independent bookstore because I love them. I always encourage people to go to independent bookstores whenever they can, wherever they can, because, you know, with a bigger group out there that you can ship a book tomorrow morning, we don't want our independent bookstores to disappear. So I have a place even on my website where you just can go called IndieBound, and you put your zip code in and you'll find out. So that relationship's good. And I had a real honor because on the third book, Hold, that just came out in October, it became one of the staff's favorites. And you can't buy that. You know, when they put your book and you walk in the door, and I'm with all the New York Times bestselling authors and stuff. And that's I just fantastic. Was like, looking. It's like the red carpet of bookstores, right?
Yeah.
So the staff really liked it that much because they get to vote on what goes out there. And I was just so honored. And that's part of the relationship. Not because they don't like something, they're going to tell you straight up. But I think just going in there, and plus I love to read, I buy books, I go to workshops there. So that's a really important relationship to me. Right. And I learned how to become a writer at this bookstore because they had mystery writing conferences and they had great coaches and they had so much mental protein and kindness. The writers and authors that came to speak were so generous, you know, Kelly Stanley and Haley Efron, and they have these great speakers. And you just sit and have lunch with them between workshops and stuff, and you learn craft. And to me, that's the challenge, is that I know between now or even when I started writing and whenever I hit, you know, the outer limits of the world, I'm going to be learning craft because it's always challenging, as you probably know, to write something as crisply as you can to describe what it is you want the reader to get. So that relationship thread, you know, I think comes through. And the publishing world is not for the lighthearted. Okay. So they're not going to go, "Hey, Mark, come on here, give us your book. We're going to hire you a publicist. We're going to get you on the," that's maybe for like a tiny, tiny percentage of people, like, or, you know, kind of, maybe, you know, like the, Harlan Coben's, Louise Penny's, you know, Stephen King's, the names that have the names, and, you know, the carpet is rolled out because they're bank, right?
Of course. Yeah. Yeah. That makes sense. So I guess, you talked a little bit about, your trilogy is available in ebook. It's available in print. It's available in audiobook as well. And that's kind of rare for a smaller publisher or a combination of independently publishing along with. How did that process work? Because that's quite an investment, isn't it?
And it was all on me. It wasn't my publisher. That was a side. That was my side.
Oh, you kept the audio rights and you did that yourself.
I did that all myself with a group called Scribe Media. And it's a whole nother world. It's kind of cool. I thought, I'm just going to embrace this because I like audiobooks and I wanted to understand as my books, because, you know, we're being produced, but I got to pick the actor. You get to audition, they audition actors, they read your words. It's kind of cool to hear your words read by somebody else. It's like, I wrote that. And and so they had 11 audition tapes I listened to, distilled it to two, and then sent more copy and to pick a gal from the Midwest. She did a great job. Plus, I, you know, when you have all these characters, you know, there's a lot of characters in my book. And so some speak Spanish, some are from Cuba. There's a little boy. She got all the accents down. She just really did a great job. So I learned all about the audiobook world. And then, so I own all the rights to it. And then there's it's an international distribution. So there's 50 places people can get their audiobooks. Again, you can get them from an independent bookstore. Libra FM has their own audio.
Libra FM, yeah. If you're using the wide distribution, yeah, Libra FM is a great way to support independent. You can probably get them through libraries. You can get them from any online retailer that has audiobooks. I'm in Canada. I have a subscription to Kobo audio program, so
yeah, exactly. Exactly.
Great. I love that.
So it was a real journey, but it was real exciting to see it all the pieces that, you know, you have to participate in and do to make sure the book is as it should be into the ear, different than, you know, the read.
Fun. I love that. So you had mentioned previous to our conversation here in an email exchange, you talked about the importance of self-care during the writing process. Now, given your medical background, I think we should lean in and listen a little bit more to someone like yourself, who's a little bit more qualified to talk about care and you know, and it's not just physical, but it's emotional, mental, etc. Can you talk a little bit about that process and what it was like for you and what you would advise for writers?
Well, thanks, Mark. And this is really near and dear to my heart because I wasn't always good with self-care. And when I was working full-time in the world I explained earlier, it was up, get out, go, do, come home, get up. And I wasn't taking care of my spirituality. I wasn't taking care of I was getting up and moving and doing some workouts and whatnot, but nothing consistently. And so when I did retire, and I did some yoga here and there, but when I retired, I went to the Chopra Center. Deepak Chopra had a center in Carlsbad for what was a 10-day perfect health program. I had no idea what I signed up for. I just knew I probably needed a big tune-up. But I learned how to meditate, and I learned how to, you know, do yoga more than I had. And I actually ended up becoming a certified yoga teacher at the Chopra Center, Hatha Yoga. Wow. And then I also learned about, how to meditate and all of those things that go with the stillness within. And then I also did a little certification at University of California, San Francisco on laughter yoga. Yes, because they use it as an adjunct to other therapy at the Osher Wellness Center. And they go to patients' room, and we got to teach, like, go in and just make patients laugh.
So hang on. So usually you think of yoga as very much like being centered and being in your mind and quiet and meditation, and then laughter. I'm like, woo, that's kind of a neat twist.
Yeah, it really is. And what's that all culminated into for wellness is that with what's happened in our world with a variety of things, both the pandemic and politics and everything in life, people are not breathing. They're not, if your listeners don't do anything else, but just stop and just take a very, very deep breath. Right. And really, because we're all holding our, we're shallow breathing because we're just like in fight or flight.
Right.
So some of the things I do is just teach. I put together a little class for our educators here in Marin County where it's called LSB, not LSD, but LSB. Laughter, stretch, and breath. And it's like a 30-minute little yum. And I actually go to the schools. I did it with the principals. I did it with the superintendents. I actually did a back-to-school event with 300 teachers. And you should have seen their faces, Mark, how fast they just leaned in. And I said, close your eyes, put your palms up, because that activates your parasympathetic nervous system. And let's all take a deep breath. And boy, the sighs. Really? So I get people to kind of close their eyes and get inside for the stillness, do some stretching. I got a great hand yoga. I can send you a link to that's on YouTube, but it's basic hand yoga because we're always over the keyboard with our phone, we're driving our cars. And I just teach folks how to like open up their hands. And, you know, at the end, when we go off, I could teach you. I'd love, it's one of my favorite things. And one of the principals at the school was like, you saved my thumb. But I've combined my wellness, my background, because I kind of know what it looks like when people don't take care of themselves for a long time,
right,
and ended up sometimes in our world of transplant or in healthcare. And I'm like, okay, these are just small little sound bites that anybody could do no matter where you are, no matter what's going on, that give you like a dollop, a tincture of health just for you. Because if we're better and we breathe, and if you can't do anything else but take 3 deep breaths every day, you got it. You know, that's a gift. And so I kind of packaged that up, and it's been a gift to just do that. And I go to some meetings and they want me to open up a big meeting, getting people in their bodies. I'm like, I'm down. And then at the end, the topper, the frosting is, I do a little laughter yoga. And the only thing that's fun about that, oh, there's a lot of things that are fun about it, is that your brain knows when a joke's not funny. It'll say, oh no, it says, I'm not laughing at you. Your body doesn't know what's funny. Your body doesn't. So if you and I just start going, I just started laughing, your body will just go with it, right? Your brain might go, oh, who's this kooky lady he's got on today? But the truth is, you could just laugh. And it's so, and it increases endorphins. So I always say to people, find a fun podcast. I love Smartless because it makes me laugh every time. Or just something you like to watch on TV, or even a little YouTube thing that when you see it, it makes you laugh.
Right.
And it really does kind of, you know, after a whole weekend of training with laughter yoga, my mouth was sore because I laughed so hard for so long. And they give you exercises to teach. So I teach those fun things, but it culminates in some good belly laughs.
I love that. I love that because it's kind of like the, it's almost like yawning, especially when you see people laugh. Sometimes just seeing people laugh makes you smile, makes you feel good because it's like this, it's a release of tension too, isn't it?
Oh, big time. And I just watched these teachers and the supervisors and the principals just like their face just lightens up. You know, we're all going back to the seriousness lane. We all have things that need to get done. We all, you know, we can all go that direction and probably have all done a great job. But I think the sprinkle of laughter is, it's certainly not going to hurt you. I can tell you that.
I love that. See, I'm feeling warm just talking about this with you. This is it's already enlightened, brightened my day. And I'm starting to be a little bit more conscious of my breathing. There we go.
Yeah. Well, I find myself every day going, I'm not taking a deep breath. What's going on? You know, because I'm just, my brain is way out in the future and, or in the past. Right. And I'm thinking, whoa. So yeah, the breathing piece is amazing, especially a big belly breath when you know, if you're thinking of Santa Claus during this time, which many are, I pump that stomach out because it makes your lower lungs get some space. And we don't breathe through the lower lobes usually. We just breathe through the first third or two thirds of our lungs. So given all the respiratory stuff, I'd say no one gets anything out of this podcast, just take three really big, deep belly breaths and sigh. You're going to feel different.
Awesome. I love that. I also, I mean, just connected to that, it almost feels like when you're laughing so hard, you can't breathe. It probably forces you to take deep breaths.
Yes, when you got a good one going.
Yeah. Oh man, I love that. Oh, Amy, thank you for the laughs. Now, not to get too serious now, but I do want to say, as we're getting close to wrapping up the interview, what advice would you offer to beginning writers, people who are just starting their journey? And what would you offer? What advice would you offer either to them or even potentially to the Amy who had the idea that she wanted to write these books back then?
I have to say that what I've learned over the years is no one can write the story that's in your head. Nobody but you. There's only one you that's in your head. You may choose just to put it on a piece of paper and pencil and say, I did it, or on a computer and say, I'm good with that. But know that that's what you're supposed, if you're being called to a story or a character or an essay or whatever, that's you. And somebody needs to hear it. Somebody needs to read it. Some besides you, your message. I've learned that over and over and over again. And surround yourself with people who support you, because there's enough people that will say, oh, come on. Like I'm not an English teacher. I'm not an English major. I'm a nurse. And my gremlins, my negative self, oh, you can't write. You don't know how to spell that well. You didn't go to school to be, you didn't read English literature. You didn't the gremlins. So yeah, that can stop you if you let them. I have a trick with my writing. I have been a writing group for over 20 some years, but one of my best friends, she and I gave our gremlins a name. So when they show up, mine's Ursula, hers Dominique, and they're going to show up. So if you got a gremlin, give them a name. They don't get to drive the car. They can sit in the back seat. Okay. Just give them a name and let them talk. Okay. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. So with Cut, the first book, I'm like, oh, what was I thinking? Did well, won awards. With Match, the second book, okay, that's doing good. So my gremlin isn't so like, really? You don't think I can write? Well, what do you think about those two books, right? I know they're not real, so I'm not crazy. But know that that's normal. The self-doubt will creep in, and also just getting your seat in the chair. It sounds easy when you're a writer, but I could tell you I could do a million things that I never wanted to do before, as opposed to sitting in the chair and just showing up to the page, as you probably know. And I think just setting a timer, or what lately I've done over the last couple of years is scheduled a power hour online with a friends. Right, we show up on Zoom. I'm going to work on hold. We tell each other, we turn off the camera, we turn off the mute, but I showed up for you. Sometimes I can show up for me, but if I made a date with you, Mark, I want to show up for you too, because I made a commitment. And then once I'm in the seat, I'm like, okay, well, let's see what's coming. Where's the magic? If it comes, if not, I showed up. And it's accountability partner is what it comes down to. So you can find an accountability partner that's going to hold you to it. Like if you have a walking partner, you know, someone that I don't feel like it, but I'll show up. Right. So I think for new people who just are listening and want to be writers, listen to that voice. Something's telling you to write something. And I would say that's important. And that's going to be your message or your voice in the world. And I think we all, if it's coming, it's meant to be. And there's more than one person out there that probably needs to hear it. So have the courage, block the time, get an accountability partner. You can acknowledge your gremlin, give them a name if you want, and have some fun with it. You know, just show up. It's actually pretty cool. It's crazy that, you know, I've written four books. I wrote a memoir in 2009, four books already. And I never in a million years thought that was ever possible, ever.
I love that. The importance of saying, Ursula, out. I'm busy. I got some stuff to do.
Yes. Thank you for your feedback. Yeah. You know, it's kind of like the naysayers in the world. Yeah. Just,
that's never I'm sorry. I'm sorry, Ursula, but Amy's busy right now. She can't see you. She's busy creating something awesome.
Call me back later or maybe don't.
Oh, man. Amy, thank you so much for such an inspiring chat. Can you please let my listeners know where they can find out more about you online?
They can go to my website. Amy, it's AMY, S as in Sam, Peele, Peele, like potato peel.com is my website. It's about a little about my background in transplant. It's got a couple links if you want to do the breath and stretch or you want to do the hand yoga. I'm going to teach Mark when we go off. And it's got sample chapters, the books, and then the audios. So there's a lot of fun groceries there if they want to go check it out. And also some more information about organ and tissue donation because it is important to me. So, yeah.
Amy, thanks again so much for chatting with me today.
Thank you, Mark, for having me. It was fun.
So I wanted to reflect on sort of going to that advice Amy left at the end for beginning writers, because I think it's so important, actually, not just for beginning writers, but for all writers, even if you've been doing it for a long time. This is a critical thing to remember, particularly because I know there's a lot of people in the author community that are worried about AI and worried that there's so much competition and who am I to write this book when all these other people can do it, or this genre, this story, this theme, etc., has been done before. And I wanted to drive home the point that she made, that you are the best person to write the story you need to write, that you want to write, the story that you can write. That unique voice, that unique perspective, that unique spin or flair or whatever it is, however you want to describe it, that uniqueness you bring to the table. And there is someone out there who needs it, who wants it, who's going to enjoy it. That's an important thing to remember. You're creating something that other people are going to get value from. Don't forget that. The second thing, and this is just so, so important, and it's why I titled the episode the way that I did, is going back to Amy mentioning how we don't breathe, we don't take deep breaths, we're taking these really shallow breaths, we're not getting that purification. And this is kind of funny because in the novel that I'm co-writing right now with Julie Strauss in Hex in the City, I have Michael, my werewolf character, I have him infected by a wraith, gets into people's bloodstreams. It feeds upon their fear and their hatred and their anger and causes them to behave badly and angrily and hastily and in violence. And one of the ways that every once in a while it takes control, and that's what it's doing to people. But one of the things that one of his colleagues who's trying to help him is suggesting is deep breaths. And it was kind of funny when Amy said that, I went, oh my God, that's exactly, it was kind of like the solution. It's like, okay, we can't get rid of this thing. Like, you're trying to exercise it. We're trying to get rid of this thing. What's the thing that can get rid of it? What's the thing that can control it? And it's the thing that can actually help you. Long, deep breaths. If you didn't do this while you were listening to the conversation that we had, I want you to do it now with me. This is so important. I've been practicing it since I chatted with Amy, and I want to practice it now with you. Are you ready? No matter where you are, you can do this, because you got to breathe, right? All right. On the count of three, we're just going to take a deep breath in. One, two, three. And of course, let it out. You don't have to hold it for very long. Just take a deep breath and then let it out. One, two, three. you've actually taken as deep a breath as you can, potentially you're feeling your chest expanding. Potentially you're feeling the richness of the oxygen coming into your lungs, purifying, cleansing. It can do that for your soul, for your spirit, for your energy. Such a good thing to do. Just try it once or twice a day. Try it particularly. This is a stressful time of year for a lot of people. Try it when you're feeling stressed. Deep breaths. Maybe one, maybe two, maybe three. A good way to refresh. A good way to recharge. There will be a link in the show notes to the hand yoga that Amy talked about. And obviously links to her website, etc. Special thing for my patrons is I kept recording when Amy did the hand yoga exercise with me. So for my patrons, there will be a video where you can check out that. Now, there's a video of Amy doing it, but hey, if you want to see how well I did or how poorly I did, you can check it out. But it was really great, because honestly, as I was doing the hand exercise, which, oh my God, I'm doing it right now as I'm recording this, I'm feeling the tension just fly out of my hands. And as writers, and she says this so beautifully, as writers, we hold so much tension. We have our hands like claws over top of our keyboards, tense and filled with energy. And it's just a chance to, oh my God, that feels so good. I'm hoping you took an opportunity not just to enjoy the wonderful conversation and the inspiration and everything that Amy talked about, but that you took some deep breaths, you took a chance to stretch, maybe even you took a chance to laugh. That's it for the reflective part of this episode. Just want one final announcement. I mentioned I would put the yoga video up for my patrons, but I did want to thank and welcome new patrons, because I've forgotten to do that in the last several episodes. I wanted to welcome and thank new patrons who support this podcast over at patreon.com/darkreflections. Welcome to Lisbeth Meredith, to Stephanie Talent, and to Angela Grit Landau. Thank you very much for becoming patrons. I hope you found access to the additional audio content that comes your way and access to all the other materials available for patrons. I am going to try to do better this year to provide more value, more content for my patrons. I do want to let you know how much I appreciate Lisbeth and Stephanie and Angela and everyone who supports this podcast over at patreon.com/starkreflections. But I, of course, want to also thank you, dear listener, for listening. I'm episode 283, and guess what? Next week, I'll be back with episode 284. If you want to support the podcast, you can always share the podcast on social media with or directly with somebody that you think would find value in these conversations, these stark reflections. You can also leave a review, of course, on whatever podcatcher you happen to listen to this podcast on. And as I said, this is the end of this episode. I hope you enjoyed the conversation with Amy and the post-conversation reflections. Until next week and next episode, this is Mark Leslie Lefebvre saying, make sure you pause and take a deep breath. And here's wishing you great writing and good stark reflections.
Thank you for listening to the Stark Reflections podcast. You can find show notes for each episode at starkreflections.ca.
The music for this podcast, Laser Groove, was composed and produced by Kevin MacLeod. Check out more of Kevin's great music at incomptech.com.
no time to